Hello, everyone, and welcome to another Vodcast by Mr. Mahan. Today's Vodcast is going to be covering what we are now calling Unit 7, still in the chemical bonding realm. And today we're going to talk about the Criss Cross Rule. And no, I'm not talking about the old school rap group, Criss Cross Will Make You Wanna Jump, Jump. Talking about the Criss Cross Rule, which is a very powerful tool for producing those formula units that we had discussed in our previous Vodcast. So if you've not watched the other Vodcast on ionic bonds, where I review how to create formula units with Lewis dot structures or how to name elements, some of this information might be lost to you here. But without further ado, we're going to jump into it. So again, with our previous Vodcast, we had looked at what exactly happens when ions come in contact with each other, when a metal and a nonmetal come in contact with each other, and will actually give and take their electrons to produce those ions. So we're going to very briefly review that, and then we're going to learn, and this is more importantly what this Vodcast is all about, how to use that crisscross rule in order to produce a formula unit. Okay, so remember the previous Vodcast we discussed and spoke about how aluminum here is going to give away its 1, 2, 3, or 2 electrons to this sulfur. We'd have to bring in another sulfur to get rid of this electron, and we'd have to keep doing that dance to get that formula unit Al2S3, which we would then call aluminum sulfide. Remember, again, you do not change the name at all of the cation or the metal, and you do have to drop the ending, drop it like it's hot, drop the ending and add IDE to our anion. Now, that's all good, well, and fine, and we can use that skill in order to produce formula units, but that can be rather time-consuming, drawing and going back and forth. So through much research and many different example problems, we have derived, as a scientific community, we've derived a shortcut. And so now for that shortcut, and again, it's what's called the crisscross rule. So first thing you want to do is you're going to want to write the two ions that you will be reacting at the quote-unquote top of your paper. This doesn't necessarily have to be the absolute top of your paper. It could just be where you're working out the problem. So if we go back to that same example problem of ALS, aluminum and sulfur reacting, I could write aluminum at the top of my paper. And because I know aluminum is in group 13, I know that it's going to give away its 3 valence shell electrons to produce a 3+ charge. Since I know sulfur is in group 16, I know it has 6 valence shell electrons it wants to go out and get to get a full 8 valence shell. And if you gain 2 electrons, you become a -2 charge. And if you remember, we had discussed in class this idea of how to get these charges. Key thing to remember is that when you lose, you become positive because you're losing negative energy. When you gain electrons, you become negative because you're gaining negative energy. And if you think about that, that almost doesn't make sense. When you lose, you're happy. When you gain, you're sad. But think of it in terms of weight. Most people, when they lose weight, really we should say mass, when they lose weight, they become happy because they've lost a couple pounds. But when they gain weight, sometimes they become negative. All right, so I've written the top two, or I've written the elements that I'm going to be reacting in their ionic form at the top of my paper. Step two of the crisscross rule is we are going to now rewrite those ions, but we're really not going to write them as ions. We're going to just write them as the original chemical symbol. So now I take my Al and my S, and I've now dropped the charge. So all I've simply done is rewrite the chemical symbol, as you can see there to the right of your paper there, with the Al and the S. Now here comes the part that it's called the crisscross for. First we're going to criss, then we're going to cross. We're going to take just the number. And yes, I'm being obnoxious on purpose, because students have a tendency to want to bring the number and the charge. We're not going to bring the charge, ladies and gentlemen. Ignore the negative and the positive when we do the crisscross. And if you take a look at what I mean, we're going to criss this too. The superscript of sulfur now becomes the subscript of aluminum. Again, just the number. Even though it's 2 negative, I just rewrite the number 2 here. And now I'm going to cross it up. I've crissed it up. Time to cross it up. So here comes the 3, just the number. The superscript of aluminum has now become the subscript of sulfur. Okay, so we've conducted steps 1, 2, and 3. Step 4 is now the last step, and this is where, again, we get so excited. We're doing our little happy dance. We're like, woo-woo, happy dance. We're all excited, and we think that, okay, I'm good to go, and let me pick that answer. But the last thing you got to do here, guys, is you got to slow yourself down, slow your roll. check yourself before you really wreck yourself, and make sure that you do in fact check to see if the subscripts can be simplified. I look at the two, I look at the three, and you may say to me, Mr. Mahan, I can simplify the two and three, but remember, our subscripts have to be whole numbers at all times. So because I cannot simplify this into any smaller whole numbers, there's no common factor between 2 and 3 that is a whole number, I am done. My simplified version is AL2S3. Last step, and I always make the joke, is now victory! And we are now very happy because I produced the exact same formula unit, AL2S3, as I would have had I done the Lewis dot structure and drawn the electrons leaving and going and everything else. But I've produced that same formula unit, that same FU, without having to draw all of those pictures. Okay, so we're going to take a look at some example problems here, ladies and gentlemen, and I have four specific problems for you. If you'd like to work these problems out on your own, feel free to pause the video now as I'm about to walk through these problems. So you could always pause the video, try them, and come back. Okay, so again, step one of the Criss Cross Rule is to write the elements at the top of your paper, okay? And in doing so, sodium becomes a 1+, chlorine becomes a 1-, because sodium's in group 1, it's going to give up its 1 valence shell electron to become positive 1. Chlorine's in group 7, the halogen group, so it's going to gain 1 electron to become a negative 1. I then rewrite my elements on the bottom here without the charges, and when I criss and cross, I should get Na1Cl1. Now the last step is just to check to see if I can simplify. I cannot simplify my ones. All I can really do is clean it up and I don't have to write the ones, and so it becomes NaCl. So as many people know, sodium chloride, which would then be now the name of this element, is just NaCl. If I were to do calcium and nitrogen, again, I'm going to set up my calcium and my nitrogen ions at the top of my paper. Calcium is a 2+, because it's an alkaline earth metal. It's in group 2. I'm going to give up the 2 to become plus 2. Nitrogen is a minus 3. Because it's in group 15, it's going to go out and gain 3. Again, rewrite the elements, criss it, cross it. The 3 comes down and becomes the subscript. The 2 comes down and becomes the subscript. And so I have produced calcium nitride. Nitrogen becomes nitride. I cannot simplify the 3 and 2, and so my final formula unit, final formula unit is the Ca3N2. If I were to crisscross boron and oxygen, set up my crisscross rule again, boron's in group 13, so it's going to become a plus 3, oxygen's in group 16, going to become a minus 2, rewrite the elements, criss it, cross it, bring the 2 down and across, the 3 down and across, yet again I cannot simplify. And so this would become boron oxide, or B2O3. Last example problem we'll do very quickly is potassium with selenium. Again, potassium is an alkali metal in group 1, so it's going to become a plus 1. Selenium's in group 16, going to become a minus 2. Rewrite our elements, criss it up, bring the 2 down and across, cross it up, bring the 1 down and across. And the only thing I can do if I wanted to simplify is drop the 1, and so I have K2SE, aka potassium seleniide. I hope this vodcast has helped you understand how to use the crisscross rule to your advantage and why we're able to use this rather than having to draw all of those Lewis dot structures. Look for the polyatomic ion vodcast for help crisscrossing polyatomic ions. Thank you and have a great day.